Trevin, the federal government recently releasing its fall economic statement. In it, the deficit seems to be declining, although they do point to a risk of a recession next year. What were some of your key takeaways? Take us through some of the numbers.
Yeah, so the fall economic statement was a rather minimalist affair, but it did have these updated fiscal projections and limited new announcements in it as well. The main story is that the strong tax revenue growth this year, supported by the recent period of high inflation, led to a lower federal deficit. And that's in the current fiscal year, and that also maybe sets the stage for the path forward as well, at least from a fiscal planning perspective. Of course, the federal government still spent roughly half of the additional windfall on additional from the additional tax revenues. But much of that spending was on items that were already announced, things like the doubling of the GST tax credit. So in terms of the numbers themselves, the federal budget deficit is projected to fall to about $36 billion in this fiscal year, which is down quite a bit from the $52 billion forecast in the last budget in April. This fiscal improvement reflected much stronger kind of tax revenues, as I mentioned, because of the high inflation, but also a little bit of weaker than forecasted program spending. And this was primarily because of unused COVID funds. One of the things that is still partially offsetting that is rising debt service costs caused by the sharp increase in interest rates this year as well, which had a bit of a counteracting effect on the fiscal position as well. But I mean, overall, the fall economic statement was a useful update of the federal government's finances that showed a bit of fiscal improvement, certainly provided guidance on how a potential recession might impact the country's fiscal position going forward as well.
They did mention, they did rather point to signs of a slowdown for next year for our country. We have since then seen some jobs data, jobs numbers, plus the people entering the workforce. Do you think that any of that data would have changed how they approach this fall economic statement?
Yeah, and so what the governments usually do when it comes to these fall economic updates is they do a bit of a survey of private sector forecasters as to what's going to potentially happen. And so the government's base case in their outlook in this doesn't necessarily say that a recession is happening. And so some of those fiscal numbers aren't necessarily based on that. But what is interesting that they did a downside risk case as well, or a certain scenario where there is a recession. And that does, of course, have a potential negative impact on the fiscal outlook when it comes to that. And it has an impact on potential contraction in employment as well during that scenario, too. Of course, that has the fiscal impact, which isn't necessarily as rosy. One of the parts of that, too, is that, of course, in the fiscal numbers that we've been provided here, that doesn't account for any government spending that might happen in the case of a potential recession. In our own economic projections at Deloitte, we're projecting a recession. We're projecting a negative quarter of growth in Q4 this year and Q1 next year as well. And so in some ways, the fall economic statement is a bit of a wait and see, or is providing the government with a little bit of buffer as well to see what happens over the next few months. And in reaction to that, they're able to have their federal budget early next year, which might include potential spending to counteract a recession, but that's still wait and see.
Before we get into what that budget 2023 might look like, what were some of the plans that the government included in this fall economic update for economic growth, for attracting investment? What was in there?
So actual new measures in the fall economic statement were relatively limited. So the government felt that it could not necessarily wait to respond to the U.S.'s Inflation Reduction Act that potentially threatened to put Canada at a competitive disadvantages in areas like the green transition to a low carbon future. And so they put in place a few measures to help those sectors be more competitive in comparison to what the U.S. is currently doing as well. Certainly, there are a number of different measures that were involved in terms of interest rates on student loans, in terms of different supports when it comes to GST tax credit. What the government was trying to do in many ways, the government might be criticized in some ways of not reducing the deficit even more with some of the windfall tax revenues. But what they did target when it comes to some of the new measures is programs in place specifically for low-income households and low-income Canadians as well. And that kind of shows the balance that they're trying to manage here.
You had mentioned budget 2023. Do any of these items point to, future fiscal policy changes or what the government might do next year when it comes to tabling that budget?
So certainly the government's going to want to see what happens over the next couple quarters, definitely, because whether we're in a recession situation or whether we're in the government's base case, that's going to, of course, have an impact on anything that they might potentially announce when it comes to the federal budget next year. Something that I imagine a number of businesses might be looking to see is a bit of a growth strategy coming out of this. Certainly there were some incentives for investment in the green transition, but when it comes to a broad-based government strategy for improving competitiveness, for improving the supply side of production, we haven't necessarily seen that yet. And I imagine that that's what a number of different business groups are going to be looking for going forward.